This is Rock and Roll Grad School with your hosts, Heidi Hedquist and Luke Poling. There's nothing more that they'd like to do than take the floor and dance with you.
Where the hell are you?
I'm not telling. You'll never know.
I'll bleep it out. You're at a playground. Are you at a pediatrician's?
I'm not at a playground. No, I'm not a pediatrician.
It sounds like you're at a pediatrician's.
Yes, I'm definitely at a pediatrician.
Are you sitting on a desk like a fire truck and has that crinkly white paper that they roll off like a butcher sheet?
I'd be so happy if I was. If there was a fire truck thing going on, you know what I always wanted was the bed from 17 again, like the Landspeeder bed. Like,
sure, yeah, that would be good.
I'd go to the pediatrician if the tables were like Landspeeder tables.
Yeah.
Or they lay you down and we put the sheet over you and it looks like you're in carbonite.
Oh, that would be great. Hello, kitties.
Yeah, make everything better.
Exactly. We're going to have a good time together because today we're having sax. We're talking with Eddie Manion, saxophonist. Are you just getting that joke now?
No, I'm just laughing that you actually tried to say that joke. So excited to say it, and I was laughing thinking of Eddie listening to the episode going, oh yeah, they had to do it.
Yep, they had to go there before. And it didn't really occur to me beforehand. I just freestyling came to me.
I thought they were clever, but I guess they're just like everybody else.
Nope, there's no off position on the genius switch. But we're talking with Eddie Manion, saxophonist extraordinaire, which I keep trying to think of other ways to explain him, and that's the only thing I can do. The list of artists he works with runs the gamut from Diana Ross to Bruce Springsteen and Super Bowl halftime shows. And I think that is all good. So we'll play our interview with Eddie and we'll go from there. So, so you too can experience the joy of sax. Can I say that?
You can. Ideally the 1970s version, not the revamped version.
It seems like you're constantly busy. I mean, your discography and your tour list is makes me feel incredibly lazy. I guess, why did you...
Unpopular.
Yeah, at the very least. Unliked, certainly. Yeah. How did you get this new record together? How did you squeeze this in amongst everything else you're doing?
Well, I started this record at the beginning of the pandemic. Maybe that was March of 2020?
Yeah.
And I really didn't have anything else to do. everything stopped for me, touring, performing. Luckily, I had a great, a three-year tour with Little Steven and Disciples of Soul. That started maybe 2017. We got Steven, we call him now Stevie Van Sant. Stevie got a call from a promoter in England, in London, Leo Green, to do his concert, a one-off concert. And so he contacted myself and Mark Ribbler, who was the Disciple of Soul band director who put the band together. I think I was the only person besides Stan Harrison that was original, that were in the Disciples of Soul 30 years ago. And
an original disciple, one of the 12,
right,
sure.
Right,
yeah. Right.
Many are chosen, few are called, yeah.
Right.
And we did the first album with Little Steven, Disciples of Soul, was 1982, called Men Without Women. But anyway, so Mark Ribbler put this band together to just to do a show. Leo Green said, well, why don't you put a band together? And Steven said, well, I haven't performed with this band in 30 years, but it worked out great. I put the horns together and did it. I think Steven came to me and asked me, he said, I want you to start writing horn arrangements. I said, okay, great. And he said, yeah, 80 songs. I said, well, that's a lot of material.
I'll be back to you tomorrow, right?
Yeah. Yeah, so we put a great show together in 2017, and that sparked Stevie's desire to keep it going and do some recording. And we wound up recording two albums, I guess, 2018, 2019. And it actually turned into, the last album is called Summer of Sorcery. Great original album. We toured for about 3 years, which was a godsend to be able to do this before the pandemic. We traveled all over the world. Went to Australia. We went to Europe a few times. It was a great experience and a great tour. And then the pandemic came, and 2020, and completely out of work. There's just, you know, everybody's in the same situation. So I figured the best thing I could do is put the best album together I possibly can, and record an album. That's what I started compiling. It's a very, very strange. It's a real compilation of a lot of different material, different styles. It's centered around the saxophone. And when I record an album, it has to do with what I think would sound songs. What songs would sound great as saxophone instrumentals, and that's my criteria solely. Is if I hear a song, I think, of course, there are a few original things on the album, but mostly cover versions. I don't really like the word cover version. I think it's just. I think the word cover song makes it sound like something that you just put together as a cover. Yeah. But you know, I mean, you know, Frank Sinatra didn't record exactly cover songs. He recorded great songs, right? That other people wrote. Anyway.
Yes, I'm with you. You have to find a better word.
So I have an original instrumental called Coastin' In that I wrote along, and at the same time I had this Christmas song that I wound up putting on the album. It's actually a bonus track. It's called The Lights Are On at Old St. John's. And so that's an original song that I wrote in tribute to my great-grandparents, Patrick Manion, who came from Ireland, who's an Irish immigrant who worked for the railroad. And came to this country in mid 1800s, and so the song "Lights Are On at Old St. John's" is a tribute to my Irish roots and my relatives that came here and built a church called St. John's, Old St. John's in Lakehurst, New Jersey. And Lakehurst, New Jersey is actually the town I was born in. And the house next to the church is the house I was born in, 1952. So that song is an original song that's a tribute to my Irish immigrant railroad, that they work for the railroad. And but besides that, there's 10 cover songs that I picked.
And how did you come up with that list of songs? Yeah. Because it's got Charlie Chaplin, it's got a little bit of everything.
Well, I wanted to have some songs that related to the pandemic and how I felt at the time, and choosing to have some continuity with the album. And Smile by Charlie Chaplin was the first thing that I listened to that I thought hit me in a way of representing what we were all feeling with the pandemic.
And
I wound up, my mom passed away in 2018, and a lot of the songs are a tribute to her. Songs like If by Bread. It's just a song I heard, and I just, and you know, at that time with my mom being in the hospital, and it just related to me personally. And also God Only Knows, Beach Boys. Yeah. That is a tribute to my mom also. My mom bought me my first saxophone when I was 10. And it was 1962. And of course, around that time, 63, 64, the Beatles came, and that I was exposed to the greatest music that we've all experienced, when that was the early 60s. And so I really went back and sort of reworked instrumental arrangements of songs that got me interested in the saxophone to begin with. And and a few of them were Spooky, the Classics Four.
Yeah.
I had a saxophone. And
yes.
So I always wanted to do my own version of that song. And of course, the Beach Boys, God Only Knows. He Ain't Heavy, He's My Brother. The Hollies, that was.
Yes. Also good.
Also around 1965, I think. So of course, but the songs, I have to make an instrumental sax record. So, I when I hear a song that or a melody of a song that I think would be an instrumental version, then I write that down, and I write it down on a little piece of paper, put it in my wallet, and I kind of forget about it for a while. Then when I get ready to make an album, I take all those little pieces of paper out, and I go, "Oh, let me listen to that again." Then I start playing along with it. But fortunately or unfortunately, I pick some songs that are not something that you can record in a few sessions. I picked some songs that were very challenging, and God Only Knows by the Beach Boys is one of the most challenging songs I've ever heard. It's not something you record in a day. It took me 2 years to record this record, because songs like
it. Yeah.
Yeah. Songs like God Only Knows, you, first of all, you got a string quartet. it has horns, it has attack piano, it's got organ, it's got French horn, and it's got, you know, background vocals. And but some songs you can't really make your own version of. Well, you can try instrumentally, but I sort of stuck to the faithful to the original arrangement on a few songs, because you have to. You can't take a song like God Only Knows and make your own, change it.
I would agree. You know, yeah.
The only thing I really changed was the melody is on saxophone, but most of the background vocal parts in the bridge and throughout the song, I had to, you know, respect what was there and totally duplicate what was there. And
would they come at you with torches if you change too much? Yeah.
it's an incredible piece of music. So I stuck to the original, but at the same time, you have to make it your own.
Yeah.
And in the end, you know, try to, you know, fit the saxophone in where it's going to make it your own song, but at the same, but be faithful to the original recording. I had a good experience I had to write an arrangement that Brian Wilson sang, and maybe it was 2017 for a benefit for little kids, rock, with little Steven put together a benefit show for Little Kids Rock. Brian Wilson was one of the guest artists. So I had to write an arrangement for that. And Brian Wilson sang it. And also when we were on tour in 2019, we were playing in California. I forget exactly where, Santa Monica maybe. And we had an off day, and Brian Wilson was performing in a small theater. So we all got a chance to go there, and I heard the song again with him singing it. So that stuck in my mind with how great that was and how great he is. You know, and then I have...
Well, before we get off of God Only Knows, did you tell Brian you were covering his song?
Oh no.
Oh, yeah, okay.
I'm not on speaking terms. I mean, I don't call him up and say, "Hey, Brian, I'm covering your song." Yeah.
And you've played with so many people, and you know, you're saying your age when the Beatles came to America. There's so much stuff that came after that are your contemporaries or people who are just a little bit older. And does that ever get intimidating with the folks you share the stage with and have gotten to play with over the years?
No,
it's just
that's amazing what you said about a little bit older. Yeah. The Beatles were just a little bit older, but at the same time, I'm pretty much at the same age. But they're just a little bit older, fortunately I got a chance to work with a lot of those people over the years. 1982 I worked with Diana Ross, and I was in her band for maybe 3 years, and we traveled, did a whole tour in the United States and Europe, and we played the big room at Caesar's Palace for maybe a month and a half. And then we would travel to Lake Tahoe and then to resorts in Atlantic City. And then we did a world tour in Europe. Those kind of experiences are, I you know, it was just a tremendous experience. Working with Joe Garcia was the conductor of the band. He was Elvis Presley's conductor. When Elvis Presley played at the Hilton in Las Vegas, sometimes people ask me what, you know, are there people that you've played with that you haven't had a chance to play with? And I always say Elvis Presley. That's
mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, he was a little bit older, a little bit too older at the time. And, you know, so I didn't get a chance to play with him. Hopefully, working with people like Dinah Ross and, you know, that whole Motown sound has rubbed off on me. And I play a lot of baritone sax too, and I really listen to a lot of Motown and R&B growing up when I first got the saxophone, and a lot of what I would listen to is, you know, some of my idols, King Curtis and Junior Walker on saxophonist playing instrumentals. And when I was listening to their recordings, they would have songs on their record and they would do their own version of Spooky by Classics Four, or their own version of Shadow Your Smile, or, you know, and I would listen to the different versions that Junior Walker would do a version, or Sandman Taylor would do a version, and King Curtis would do a version of the same song. And I was always comparing these different versions of instrumentals, or didn't call them, they weren't cover songs, but they were, mm-hmm. right. It was great songs that everybody, you know, did their own version of that song. And I think that's what I still do. I still, you know, like to take over where King Curtis, you know, he would record these songs, and then those songs would always stick in my mind, like Georgia on My Mind, Hoagie Carmichael's song that, that's on my album. So I, you know, have my own version of that same song. Yeah.
A lot of what you mentioned, obviously a lot of this, the songs you chose were a tribute to your mom, and she was really instrumental, no pun intended, in purchasing your first sax.
Yeah.
What is it like looking at your incredible career through her eyes?
Well, first of all, my mom was my greatest fan. She was, she's an inspiration for, you know, she followed everything I ever did. As a matter of fact, you know, I have a scrapbook that she put together, and maybe it's about this thick. And, anything that I ever did with Bruce Springsteen or Southside Johnny and the Asbury Jukes, or Little Steven, Disciples of Soul, Diana Ross, Robert Cray Band. There would always be articles, you know, mostly in the Asbury Park Press and Asbury Park, New Jersey. And she would get the paper every morning. And if there was anything in the paper that had to do with me or the people that I worked with, she would take that article and put it in a scrapbook, and, you know, she would immediately call me, Eddie, you're in the paper. Okay. All right. Not again.
Oh, no. What the
fuck? You know, and so I have this scrapbook that she kept of everything, you know, and she kept all my postcards when I was in Europe with Bruce Springsteen, 1988 Tunnel of Love tour. She would keep everything, and when she passed in 2018, I, you know, it was hard, but the last thing she said to me was in the hospital. She said, "Eddie, I just want you to go to New York, start rehearsals with Little Steven, Disciples of Soul, and then go on tour and have a good time." So, you know, I pretty much did that. And you know, so, you know, that was in 2018. So she was a big inspiration for this album. The entire album is dedicated to her.
That's awesome.
And she's
biggest fan, manager. Historian, she's everything.
Biggest fan, sometimes the only fan. But
that's all you need. You only need one.
That's all I need. Right?
Yeah.
Just needed her. And and even the Christmas song that I have on this album, "The Lights Are On Old St. John's," is a tribute to her too, because, you know, we live next door to the church, and I have so many fond memories of growing up in Lakehurst, New Jersey, everything That's about awesome. That. Yeah.
I love that.
So I hope I'm not rambling too much here.
No, we love it. No. This is not at all.
Yeah.
No, this is what we love, conversations that are conversations, sharing your stories and sharing, you know. We'd be like, well, we got to go if it was, you were giving us one word answers.
Okay.
No, so we love it. It's perfect.
Yeah. So the record was a real challenge. But like I said, once you start songs like "God Only Knows" and "Georgia," and you start adding string quartets and all the instrumentation, it takes a while. So that's why it took 2 years. And I would go in, you know, I don't have my own studio, but there's something about working with Bruce Springsteen and
I've heard. Yeah.
So they say.
and Little Steven and Southside Johnny. One thing that really has stuck with me is the quality of the recordings that they do. You know, I'm spoiled. When I work with any of those people, usually entails the best studios, the best musicians. They take their time and because of that, it cost me a fortune. Because the quality of my recording, It has to be the same. I can't record at home. I can't record, you know, I have to go into a great studio. I have to use, you know, the best microphones. I have to use Neumann microphones. I have to use the studio I used a studio in New Jersey called Surefire for my basic tracks, and there were eight songs we did on basic tracks, and I basically used the Disciple of Soul rhythm section for eight songs. Mark Ribbler on guitar and Jack Daly on bass, Rich Mercurio on drums, Andy Burton on keyboards, and that was the primary rhythm section, and I recorded these songs at a studio called Surefire in Long Branch, New Jersey, and the other five songs I recorded in where I live now in Pittsburgh, at the Volt recording studio, and the songs were recorded by Jimmy Hoyson, great engineer. He's had some Grammy awards, so all 13 songs were mixed by Mark Ribbler and Jack Daly at Jack's studio and Doug Deep Productions in Asbury Park, New Jersey. And the 8 basic tracks were recorded by Joe DeMeo in Long Branch, New Jersey. But what I'm trying to get at is that, you know, these are great studios with Neve boards and, you know, actually the board we recorded on at the Volt recording studio was originally owned by George Harrison. It's an old Neve board. But that's the quality I have to have, you know. And I take my time. It took 2 years. I'd go in every 2 weeks and work on something. And I got background vocals. I have some of the greatest background vocals on a few songs. I have Cindy Mizell singing. She worked with me with Bruce Springsteen. And
if you need a backup singer, she's pretty good.
Yeah, she worked with Luther Vandross. What's the name of that movie that she was in?
With Darlene Love. Stardom.
Yeah, she's in that. Yes. You know, yeah. So that's incredible with her. And I used Jesse Wagner from Little Steven, Disciples of Soul, and a friend of mine, Lisa Lowell. Or worked with Bruce Springsteen on the Seeger Sessions band, and with Southside Johnny and the Asbury Jukes. So I got some great singers and background singers, and I like to do instrumentals with background vocals. I like to, you know, and it's not only just the sax, but I like to incorporate the background vocals so people can relate to the song. And that's the whole thing. If you're a saxophone instrumentalist, and you do R&B, you play jazz, you have to make the record interesting for the general people. You can't go over their heads, you know.
Right.
You know, so that's pretty much what I like to do. I like to, you know, expose people to some good music that maybe they never heard of before, and incorporate a couple of standards. Like on my album, I have When Sunny Gets Blue. A lot of people may have never heard that song. And I also have a song called Deep Purple, which is like a jazz standard, really.
Yeah.
So I have a little bit of that, but you don't want too much of that. You know, you want to have songs that people have heard before, because it's instrumental. So that's why I try to keep it simple, and I try to I'm a pretty melodic player. I'm not trying to change the world or prove anything. I love the melodies of certain songs, and I just want to record what I want to record. Something that sounds like me, and it's all about the saxophone. It's about the sound of the saxophone. That's what got me interested when I was 10 years old, and it's still to this day. I'm looking for a sound. I'm trying to improve my sound. I'm trying to work on my sound and get the best sound on recording. And so I'm pretty much doing that. I mean, I'm just documenting what I sound like, and trying to do that through some songs that people will know, I'm trying to relate to people that love the sound of the saxophone.
And people do love the saxophone. I feel all the instruments, the listener, the audience is so drawn to a sax more than any other instrument.
Yeah. And I don't want to, you know, I like to relate to jazz experts. you know, people that are great jazz musicians. But at the same time, I've always wanted to relate to the guy who just loves the saxophone. A guy that doesn't have a jazz collection. He doesn't really know who Charlie Parker is, or he doesn't really know who, you know, Dizzy Gillespie is, or, you know, but he just knows that he likes the saxophone, you know, and, you know, that's, you know, I've always had a pleasure of, you know, going into a bar and playing instrumentals and having some guy just that sitting there going, I love the saxophone, you know. It's like, and what do they love about the saxophone? I mean, maybe they heard Harlem Nocturne by Sandman Taylor at one time, or maybe they heard Yakety Sax by Boots Randolph, but that's kind of the extent of their what they've been exposed to as far as saxophone. But but I love to incorporate a lot of that on my albums and revive that feeling of just an ordinary person that just loves the saxophone and you know, so that's, I try to, you know, do instrumentals that aren't that everybody can relate to, and you know, and try to bring back the instrumental greatness that the saxophone had in the 50s and the 60s, and you know, yeah, my great grandfather, I mean my grandfather, Joe Clark, you know, one day he called me up and he says, "Can you play Yakety Sax by Boots Randolph?" He says, you're not a saxophone player unless you can play,
right?
You know, Yakety Sax. I said, "No, well, I'll learn it for you, Grandpa." So I went over to his house and played him Yakety Sax, and he's, "All right, you're a saxophone player."
Pass the test.
Pass the test. Yeah.
Well, that's got to be opening track on the next record.
Yeah. On the next record.
Yeah. Coastin' In by Eddie Manion is available right now wherever you get your music. You can also order copies from his website, eddiemanion.com, and you can follow him on Facebook and on Twitter, where he is at Eddie Manion.
You can check us out on all the various socials. Be sure to visit our website at rockandrollgradschool.com, and don't forget to leave us a review.
Today's show is produced by myself and Heidi Hegquist. Our reluctant producers are John Sauvay and Sandy Stone. Our willing producers are Rachel Allen and Randy Jeanette. Our intern is Zach Jackson. This one's for Philippe. Thank you, good night, and may all your favorite bands stay together.